Listen, happy last day.
Try to remember me like this.
I'm Milling About with Daryl Wine and Zoe Lister-Jones, and they're doing How It Ends, if you can see behind me. Hi, guys.
How's it going?
Really good. So obviously you're not physically together. So where is everybody in the world today?
Zoe's in New York. Yeah, Zoe's in New York and I'm in LA right now.
Are you working on some projects and that's why you're sort of not together at the moment?
Yeah, exactly.
So, you know, it's interesting. Everybody last year was doing something crazy in lockdown, whether we were baking sourdough bread or, you know, learning a craft. And you guys made a movie.
Yes, that's true. I know, it's crazy. We actually, part of us wanted to be, you know, learning how to make sourdough bread. Although I will say I did have a sourdough starter for many months, if not a year, Zoe can attest, in the fridge, and did make some sourdough, or made some actually more pizza.
Yeah, you never made a sourdough.
That's true. Pizza.
I completed a film, released it, and shot a film with me all in quarantine. And I did have some envy for my friends who are becoming like hobbyists. I wanted to learn a new craft.
I hear you. But you know, all your friends seem to have been in this movie.
Yeah, that's true. We have very talented friends.
But they just had to show up for one day. We had to spend much more time working on it.
Yeah. Except for Kaylee. Kaylee was in for the long haul.
That's true.
So tell me, first of all, how she like mirrored you, Zoe. She really did look like your younger self.
You know, I directed her in this film, The Craft Legacy. And that film was, I had written her character to be sort of a version of my adolescent self. So we had done a lot of work together already in that realm, and then had also become very close friends. And I think, so we were very much in sync. Like there wasn't a rehearsal process where we had to like figure out how to mirror each other. I think we were just inherently, we continue to be just sort of twin flames in a really exciting and nourishing way, which is always, you know, so cool to find creative collaborators that feel just organically a part of your world. So we didn't, I mean, right, Dee? I don't think that there was much of anything. I mean, we did some like literal mirroring as we would walk down the street. We would be like, okay, now sneeze together. And now, you know, as little winks about our characters being in step. But no, it was a pretty, just intuitive process.
Would you like to add to that, Daryl?
Everything she said was, I thought, great.
You guys, I have a feeling you always agree for, you know, to be-
We definitely don't.
Nope.
Well, how do you collaborate with each other? You know, you being that you are directing together, writing together, acting together, living together.
Well, we didn't act together in this, but we did act together in our first film, Breaking Upwards. I think our collaboration over so many years has created a shorthand. So there are many things that we do agree on, and we have the same taste and things that we like. And so that makes everything a lot easier when you're working with someone new, whether it's a writer, an actor, producer, you don't really know where they shake out on certain ideas. So that's really great in terms of our partnership. And I think we just, you know, spent a lot of time talking. It's just like, let's just keep talking about the thing. And, you know, that's what we like to do. We like to wrestle with a lot of ideas in our personal lives and also on screen, you know, the interpersonal dynamics between relationships, I think, is always interesting to us, you know, psychosexually, sociopolitically. And yeah, we just, I don't know, we just kind of create what's inside of us at the moment in time and whatever is speaking to our hearts. And this was no exception. You know, early pandemic, we were going through a lot and feeling sad and depressed and trying to figure out a way to channel those emotions into a new piece of art.
Yeah. It's interesting because this is described as an apocalyptic comedy. And I really did laugh. It made me feel, you know, sort of like you say, like it was such a scary time. So what were you guys going through then? And how did this sort of take you out of that?
I mean, I think we were facing the like overwhelm of emotions that most of the world was facing. You know, I think it was just such an unprecedented time for us all, and that none of us were equipped emotionally to really know how to deal with essentially like a very apocalyptic future, and an uncertain future that, and to be so isolated and to be robbed of so many of, you know, the everyday events and human connections that we took for granted. So I think, yeah, we were anxious. We were, as Daryl said, very depressed. I think we were fearful and confused. And I think as artists, both Daryl and I tend to navigate those moments through our art. And so this was no exception.
Well, it's great that you have that, you know, that sort of creative outlet. I want to talk to you about some of the, I think there was a lot of improvisation. It seemed like there was. Yeah.
Yeah, it was like half written and half working off of a structured outline with story beats that we knew we wanted the actors to hit. And then we allowed them to improvise around those parameters.
So what was the more shocking improv that came out of this, would you say?
I mean, I don't know that it was shocking, but the Lamorne Morris and Zoe scene, you know, who he plays Larry, her ex, and, you know, cheated on her many times. And the things that Lamorne came up with, in addition to what we had kind of guided him to do, was just like so surprising. And everyone in this cast are so genius at improvisation. And even some who are more just traditional straight actors, when we just let them go, it was amazing to see them just like channel such brilliance. But that scene in particular really tickled me behind the camera. I just like couldn't stop laughing at like these different things that he would come up with. And Zoe as well, just her reaction, like keeping such a straight face and holding him accountable. Like there's this moment where he like starts choking up and she's like, "You're not crying." And it was just this like funny little element that after that moment, he actually did start laughing, which we cut, but right before that was just like a classic example of what comes when you're just like coming up with stuff on the spot.
Yeah, I mean, we had there were so many of our actors that are such brilliant improvisers. So I think we wanted to give them the freedom to play. And then, you know, there are a number of scenes, all of Kaylee and my scenes, and scene with Bradley Whitford and Helen Hunt that were all written, and we stuck to script pretty strictly.
They were so brilliant as your parents.
Yeah.
Like, what great casting. And of course you must have cast this as well.
Yes, we did.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were gonna say something.
Oh no, yeah, no, I mean, we called as many friends as we could and asked if they wanted to be in this at the time. And we were overjoyed with how many people were excited to get back to creating art and having fun. And people were coming with so many different sets of emotions. So we just welcomed that and said, you know, whatever you're feeling, cool, you know, bring that to the scene. And if you're, you know, too scared to come out of the house, that's great too. We you do you.
So how did you get around that sort of COVID restrictions? What did you do?
We just followed the guidelines that were coming out at the time. You know, everyone was safe and masked and off camera and all the PPE and just all the safety protocols that were literally being created at the time. The city and state health guidelines, we just followed those. I mean, as you see in the film, we're all outside. Everyone's 6 feet apart.
Yeah, so we really did part of the guidelines. So I think we actually took it a step further. We like created a narrative that could take place entirely outside and 6 feet apart, outside of like a couple scenes in the beginning of the film.
Yeah, all the makeout scenes we saved for the special features.
Or you'd have like a like silicone in front of everybody.
Yeah.
So what's your next project for Mr. Lister? What's next?
That's a good question. We're writing different things right now. So stay tuned. We'll have to see what's in store for 2022.
Yeah.
It's ironic that Awokens was posted on your YouTube page, Daryl, a day after lockdown.
Oh, I don't know when that was posted, but that's funny that you caught that.
Yeah, I thought that was crazy. What's happening with that? I loved it. I loved that little pilot that you shot. It
was thank you so much. That sadly was a moment in time that, yeah, just didn't get picked up to series, but that was a really fun ensemble. And yeah, that is all it will be. So hopefully, yeah, people can check that out.
Yeah, on YouTube.
Yeah, on the tube.
So what do you want audiences to come away with after they see how it ends? And what would your last day really be like?
I mean, I think, well, you can speak for yourself, Dee, but I feel like it would be pretty similar to to the film. Like, I think I would probably want to visit the people that mean most to me and say the things that I needed to say and connect for the final time. And I would probably eat. Yeah, just a lot of like eating, dancing would be involved. I'd spend all my money. I'd buy everything I'd ever dreamed of buying. I don't know. What about you, Dee?
I would try heroin. I would, we'd have a big party and yeah, just eat and laugh and orgy.
Sounds like a plan.
Exactly.
Yeah. But in terms of what people should take away, I mean, what we want them to take away, like, I think I think we would love for viewers to just be moved, however they choose to be moved, but that, yeah, that the film could serve as a reflection of maybe some of the emotional questions and quandaries that they've had over a lifetime, but also over the past year and a half in particular. And then also to find levity amidst those questions and to be able to laugh and escape and have some catharsis.
Exactly.
Cool. Thanks again, you guys.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you so much.
All right, take care. How it ends, okay. Daryl Wine and Zoe Lister-Jones.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much.
Like Tom Hanks said in Castaway, life's a box of chocolates, so we die alone.
Right. Eyeballs, you got nice eyes.
I'm celebrating tonight. I should have been dead a long time ago.
Always news.
Always refreshing.
Always candid.
Always milling about.
Robin Milling delivers what celebrities are saying to you.